Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I love you guys.
Right. Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful day, even though it is not sunny. The sun is not shining. But we are here. But the sun is shining. Right, right. I posted a message earlier trying to get my crew, my following to be able to watch this too and get them on board. But that's what I was saying. I was saying, you know, that it might not be sunshine outside, but what is it that's in your heart? That's the most important part. So happy Mother's Day to all those that are mothers, all of those that fill in as mothers, and all of those who love like mothers.
Amen.
I have a devotional that I want to start with. Well, first let me pray. Thank you, Father God, for another day. Thank you for allowing us all to be in this building, Lord. Thank you for allowing those that are watching that were not able to come, Lord. I just thank you for your grace and your presence in this room today, Lord. And I just thank you for the encouragement. I thank you that whatever comes out of my mouth is only of you, Lord. I leave everything of myself out. And I just want to be able to glorify you through all that I do and just to be able to stay confident in your word and walk in your word and allow people to be able to understand what I'm saying so that they can teach. They can leave with something inside. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
It says, we who are strong ought to put up with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. Romans 15:1-3. Father, one of the difficult things about being a mother is to teach my children to be tolerant of others who are not like them. In spite of my efforts, my children are capable of following the crowd, ridiculing, jeering, and being insensitive to the feelings and the needs of others. You have always taught us by example, showing us how to love the stranger, to withhold judgment, to help the ungodly, and to bear the weaknesses of others. Your son kept company with outcasts and took on their burdens. Stir up in us and our children, Lord, your compassion for the people who are different, and help us to understand the truth. We are brother's keepers. As we all know, I mean, as we're all servants of the Lord, you know, we work diligently and we work to glorify him through everything that we do. So you know that the devil works, tries to work, tries, emphasis on tries.
Yes.
But it's how we conquer and move forward, right?
That's right.
So I want to say give yourselves a round of applause because by the grace of God, you're here and you didn't allow the devil's tactics to keep you home.
Amen.
You know? All right, so if you are a note taker, the subject of my message today is light behind bars. A lot of times we know the saying life behind bars, but instead I want to emphasize light behind bars. Today we're going to be in Philippians, and we're going to start in chapter 1, 12. Okay. So just kind of giving like a little insight on what's taking place. Paul's in prison, and he's in prison because he was actually doing the Lord's work. He was actually preaching and teaching of God, about God. And because of that, now he's in prison. He's not understanding why necessarily, but he's there. And if you can think about it, like you think prison is, you know, it's trapping, there's not much really you can do but to think about what's taking place. And a lot of the times, you know, when we're in our own prisons, we have nothing to do but to, you know, grovel and to just continue to walk around murmuring and complaining and instead of saying, you know what, Lord, how can I utilize this time to be able to push myself forward? How can I use this time to grow? How can I use this time to make an example out of myself to show others how they can be more like you? He doesn't explain very much what he's going through in prison. You know, it's very short, very minimal. You know, he's in jail, so it's probably overcrowded. The food's probably horrible. And he just, you know, that's not somewhere he would want to be. But instead of him groveling and just curling up in the corner and shunning God and cursing God and telling God how disappointed he is because I'm doing your work. So why am I in prison? Why am I in prison and I'm doing your work, Lord? So it makes me wonder, what's Paul's priorities? Priorities to know what is happening in me is always more important than what is happening to me. So do I have it right? Am I allowing all these external events take place to burden me, to harbor me, to keep me from where I need to be? It's not allowing me to be able to focus on what is to come. Instead, I should be relying on what God has in store for me through this storm. And in the midst of all this, again, he's not groveling, he's not woe is me. He's staying focused. He decided to focus on the fruit. So there's something, obviously, so if we're in jail or we're in prison or, you know, we don't feel as though that we're growing. We feel as though that we're confined. We can't do very much. But he stays focused on the fruit. And there's no fruit without a root. So something has to be happening on the inside of him. Something has to be happening beneath the surface. Amen. God has to be growing something inside of me greater than I could even imagine. Right. But I'm still in prison. All right, Lord. I know who you are. I know the mighty works you can do. So why am I still here? That's not his question. He's not questioning God. So we're going to go to chapter 12 in Philippians. Excuse me, chapter 1, verse 12. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. So not only is he not murmuring, complaining, disappointed, frustrated, angry at God, he's saying, okay, Lord, I know what you did is only to glorify you. So I'm in prison, but as long as I'm glorifying you, then I'm serving my purpose. So again, there's something happening in the soil. There's something that's happening underneath the surface. Something is beginning to take root in my heart because I'm changing. I'm not like everyone in the prison. I'm not angry. I'm not frustrated. I'm not looking at this food like, how could this nourish me? How could this water even quench my thirst? He's not thinking these things. He's rooted in fruit. And God gave us a root system. So it's a lot like plants. I know that's not a real one, but we're going to think it's a real one today. It started as a seed. But before the seed, it was soil. Right? So you have to plant the seed. And then you have to water the soil to embrace the seed so that it can begin to bloom. But you can't just let it bloom. You have to prune it. You have to take care of it. You have to invest in it. You have to show love to it. You have to allow the sunshine to hit it in particular ways. You have to turn it. You have to shift it. You have to do things because it's a part of the process. It's a part of God's plan. In the midst of this, he's teaching us to focus. Because God is rooting in me. He's establishing something in me that I can bear more fruit. Because again, if we don't have a good root, we can't have good fruit. And if we don't have good fruit, we don't have something that will last a long time. It'll dull down. Our light will dim. The one thing that God is allowing us to have is to have light, to be able to see him through others.
Yes.
And for others to see him through us. Now, this might not be the prettiest part of my life, but by faith, I believe is going to be the most productive.
Amen.
you know? You know, going through all of these things, Lord, why? Okay, I'm staying true to your word. I'm staying focused on the word. It's like Peter, he didn't just walk on water. He walked on the word. He walked on the word because the word was true and God said, come. The word is important. And not only is this going to be the most productive for you, the most productive parts of our lives will not always be the prettiest.
Amen.
So it's going to be some band-aids that you're going to have to put on. But you have to realize if you're moving forward in the right direction and you're blooming and you're pruning and you keep watering and you let the sunshine come in, you will continue to see how God is showing up in your life continuously. The greatest miracles in your life will come in the middle of the biggest messes. God wants you to wait. He wants you to stay fruitful. He wants you to stay with your eyes on the prize. He wants you to have that narrow tunnel vision. Just stay focused. You see the light, stay focused. Allow your light to stay with the focus of the light. So my question to you is, how do you handle the storm? How do you handle your storms? Do you talk to God about it and say, Lord, I know whatever you have in store for me is good for me. I know whatever you have is bigger and better than what I can even imagine. Or do we take the other route of the doubt of uncertainty? Yeah, I really don't know what's going to happen. So, you know, Lord, you really, like, come on. Like, what's up? Like, how are you just going to leave me? How are you just going to leave me like this? I have nobody in here. Well, he did have Timothy. Well, I have him, but I don't have anybody else in here. So then we go to verse 13. As a result, it became clear throughout the whole palace guard to everyone else. This is my favorite part of the verse. I am in chains for Christ.
Yes.
So most of the times we think of chains as bondage. We think of it as, you know, we can't go anywhere. We're stuck. But in this instance, he's saying it with such confidence, with such certainty. He's uncertain of what's about to take place, but he's very, very much certain as to him being so certain that he's in chains for Christ. And he's okay with that. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. So he's in this dark place, light inside of him, something's growing inside of him, and him being on the inside in chains for Christ is allowing others to see the light in him.
Amen.
So it's a sense of confidence that, you know what, let's define it. The presence of faith does not eliminate uncertainty. It actually operates by uncertainty. Faith is the confidence in what we hope for and assurance the Lord is working even though we cannot see.
Amen.
Confidence, belief in oneself, but God confidence, depending completely upon God and his strength to handle the things that are in your life, whether they be currently in your storm or yesterday when you signed papers on your new house. That God confidence, you got to keep it. You got to keep it when you're in the storm, in prison. You got to keep it, because if you don't keep it when that door opens and you're released out of prison and you say, deuces, thank you, Lord, looking out, what have you learned?
Amen.
Where did it go wrong in the soil that you bloomed this beautiful plant? And then you just cut it and say, well, you know what, it was a good run.
Mm.
Patience. I had to throw that one in there. That's something God is working on with me. Man. Patience. Bearing pains, trials calmly, without complaint. It's a steadfast, despite your opposition, patience. Lord, I'm in this prison. I know, and this is not where I think I should be. I understand you think I need to be here. You got it. I'ma just Remain patient. I got you. You got me, I got you. His certainty wasn't about the outcome, because he's not sure. He's not even sure if he's getting out today, tomorrow, next Friday. He's not sure. He's not sure of the outcome. But he keeps speaking about God's presence in the process. How many times are we going through something and we're not really sure, you know, are you even there, God? Like, I mean, I'm not sure if that's my conscience talking or is it you, because it sounds like you, but I'm not sure, so I feel like you're not here, so I'm gonna just act like you're not here, so I'm gonna just keep moving. But instead, through all of this, he stays certain because God's presence is in the process. So he knows that God is preparing something, and as long as he's in prison and people are seeing his glory through him being in prison, then the gospel is going forward. One of the few things that we do actually have control of in my outlook would be focus. Like we have the ability to control what we focus on.
Yes.
Right.
It's the prep work. You know, as soon as you wake up, are you going straight to your phone? Oh, let me check out Facebook. Who's up right now? Oh, who had a bad day? Let's tell us. Who had a bad day? Or you know what? I had a bad day, so let me... I'm on Instagram, I'm seeing all this. I can control it. I can control what I view. I can control what I allow inside of me.
That's right.
Because what if I allow something that's inside of me that doesn't need to be there, how can I prune that properly? I'm pruning, but I'm injecting, and then I'm pruning, and then I'm injecting, and then I'm pruning, and then I'm injecting. It's not an equal trait. It needs to be one or the other. But it's okay not to know. We're in a world that we feel like we gotta know everything. Everything. You know what's going on. The news tells you everything. The news tells you everything that they want to tell you, but are they really telling you what you need to know? And not only is it okay to not know, when you don't know, it opens doors to wisdom. And wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. The quality of being wise. So if I don't know and I'm not allowing all of these negative things to bombard me, then I can think clearly. I can look for the wisdom. I can look for the things that God has for me instead of dwelling in the midst of the world. And I'm not saying more so like a physical focus. I mean, of course, we can focus to a degree. It's like kids, you know? I mean, they're being great right now. How old are they? They'll probably have a good 10 to 15 minute time span, and then they'll get up, they'll run around, you know, and then they'll shh, then they'll sit down, and it'll happen again. I'm not talking about a physical focus. I'm talking about an emotional focus.
Yes.
A spiritual focus. Focusing on your priorities. What are your priorities? What's happening inside of me? Not what's happening to me. Which actually brings me back to Ephesians 6:10 and 6:11. How are we operating? How are we preparing ourselves to have spiritual focus and emotional focus and focusing on your priorities? By putting on the armor of God. Specifically, finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take stand against the devil's schemes. You guys fought against devil's schemes today to get here. You were focused.
Amen.
You were focused on what you needed to be focused on. You were focused on pruning yourself. You were allowing God to prune you today. By being here, by listening, by hearing me, just by being in the midst of his presence. He wanted you here to know he's pruning you. He's preparing you. You may be in a dark spot. You may not have what you need. My car broke down on me, 2 weeks ago? 2 weeks before that, I just put almost $500 into it. And then the next week it broke down. And then he's, oh, it's probably going to be another $1,500. Okay, Lord, now this is me growing. Before, I would have been like, for real? Like, come on, this is a 2017, why is my car breaking down? I paid good money for it. but it was because I had put so many miles on it and I wasn't properly pruning it as importantly time frame wise as I should have. But in the midst of it, I did not fret. I went, I got a rental. I said, I know I have to go to work this week. My dad was able to help me with a car a couple days that I didn't have to pay for a rental. He provided ways for me. I did not fret. It was amazing. It actually felt so good to just be like, Lord, like I'm a grown adult. I can make these decisions. I can make these choices. I have the resources. I have great credit. I have this. I've been working so hard on my credit. I'm working so hard to build this great credit. Paying things and on time and extra and this and that. And I said, you know what? Let me go to see if I can get another car. God's good.
Amen.
Came home in a brand new car. Got to work every single day that I needed to go to work.
Yeah.
Floating, coasting. I feel like I'm close to him, closer to him. I really float like I'm on cloud nine. And this isn't to brag or be facetious or anything like that. The sort is just to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you that I didn't have to struggle and I didn't have to cry and I didn't have to do it this time.
Yes.
I've done it so many times before.
Amen.
But you're pruning me.
Amen.
And I'm able to say thank you.
Yes.
It's only because of you. I get excited because I can go on Instagram and just be full of joy. Full of it. Like, oh yeah, I'm only in this car because God's in it. I had a check me moment. If you follow me on Instagram, you saw my check me moment. But if you didn't, I'll tell you about my check me moment. Beautiful car. Again, 2020, 25,000 miles on it. Nissan Altima.
Awesome.
Cruising. Blessed.
Amen.
And I'm cruising one day. And I had always, like, had people who had sunroofs in their cars and stuff like that or whatever. And it's like the little things that you think of, like, after the fact. So I'm in the car and everything. It's a beautiful day. All my windows are down. I got the music all the way up. I'm chilling. I'm grooving. I'm doing my thing. And I'm like, oh, it would have been so awesome if I could have had a sunroof. Like, I'm excited, wishing I had a sunroof. And I'm like, girl, if you had a sunroof, you would be drawing on it. You'd be wild. You would be wild. Like pulling up everywhere. You know, you don't need no sunroof. You do not need a sunroof. And that was my check me moment, because I was looking at what could be cool, something that I could have had, but I wasn't looking at what God blessed me.
Amen.
I wasn't focusing on the fact that my credit got me A1, my money I had, boom, here you go, here's my down payment. Oh, you can trade my car in? All right, bet. It's an even trade, say less. That's even better. But I wasn't focusing on what God had blessed me with, so I wasn't focused.
Amen.
So we talk about fruit, and without a root, you can't have fruit. But the fruit of the Spirit speaks about love, joy, forbearance, which is agreement, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Ooh, how many people just got hit right now? Saying those things hit me. Agreement. How many times do we really agree with people? I want it my way.
Amen.
You don't really know the answer to that. Gentleness. How gentle are we with people? Self-control. Do we have self-control? Do we practice self-control? Fruit without root doesn't last long. It's a temporary thing.
Yep.
We want something that's sustainable. The fruit of the Spirit is joy. But the root of the Spirit is priorities. And what are your priorities? What are you planted in is what matters.
Amen.
What matters to you? What matters to you that will glorify God? What matters to you that will say, you know, it has nothing to do with me. I'm just in this beautiful car driving it, but I'm a blast in my praise and worship, and I love pulling up next to people because it's like she's doing too much. No, I'm not. I'm being a light to you right now, because at some point you're going to think about that girl who rode up next to you, and whoever was in her speakers was talking. She was talking to you. They were letting you know that God makes a way.
Amen.
So we go through, we continue through Philippians, and he's basically just saying, you know, like, the breakdown of, you know, there's people out here who are preaching of God or of Christ, but it's in an envious way, a rivalry way, you know, Lord, I'm still in prison, I was doing your work, but I'm still remaining faithful, because as long as your word is spoken, as long as people find out about you, then what does it really matter? At the end of the day, it has nothing to do with me. But knowing people, knowing about you is what's important. And after he says that, he says, rejoice. Rejoice. He's happy. He's having a party in prison right now. Like, he's having his own party in prison. People are looking at him like, dude, you're locked up. Like, who knows when you're even going to get out. More than likely, you're probably going to get crucified. And, or stoned, or whatever it is. You're about to, your life's about to be done. But he's like, no. The God that I serve will always supply my need.
Amen. Yep.
He's going to get me up out of here, because this is not where I belong. This is my temporal. And it's a beautiful thing, because even though the hardship of Paul being in the prison, the only reason we have Philippians is because he was there.
Amen.
The only reason we have the scripture that's called I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me is because he was in prison.
That's right.
The only reason that my God will supply all of my needs, and knowing that in a confident manner, is because he was in prison.
That's right. Amen.
He doesn't have any idea how it ends, but he is certain that God will supply all of his needs. You don't need to know every minute. You don't need to scroll into the news and say, okay, well, now it's 150,000 people who this, and numbers can be wrong. As long as at the end of the day, and I don't know what's taking place, but God still brings his glory into the midst of it, I'm cool. I'm good. So I encourage you to stay focused. I encourage you to limit your media intake. I encourage you to limit your Facebook intake. I encourage you to limit your social media, your emails, your news, your this, your that, and all the outsourced things. Because at the end of the day, yes, we have a serious thing that's taking place in this world, as it has forever. There's always been something that has hindered generations or particular bodies of people or whatever. There's always been something that was deteriorating us.
Amen.
So now that it's 2021 and everyone's freaking out, yes, it's still a very serious thing. People have passed from this, unfortunately. And we have to be grateful that we knew those people in the midst of it. We have to grow from it. We have to allow God to prune us through this. But we have to remember that everything that's on the outside of this world, we cannot continue to be conformed to it. Yes, you live here on earth. Yes.
Yes.
That's your purpose. That's your purpose, to be here and live it out. Do what you're supposed to do for God. That's what Jesus came here for.
Hallelujah.
He came here to serve a purpose, but he came to serve a purpose for us.
Amen.
And that's what Paul's doing. Paul's serving his purpose, his time, his prison sentence. In a sense, is to prepare us. Not needing to know the things that you're not directly affecting or affected by. So, if I'm having a conversation with your mama, and my dad's in the back and he's nibbity nose. I know, that's why I did it that way, because I didn't want you to feel no type of way. It's Mother's Day, I'll give you some shine, though. And say, Bud comes over and he's just totally in the conversation. Love you, Bud. He's allowing himself into something that's not even affecting him. So now he can be creating something that has nothing to do with him being in it. That's why Paul stayed true to what he needed to be doing. He wasn't in anybody else's face. He wasn't doing this. He wasn't doing that. He stayed true to his purpose. You also don't need to know all the details to take your next step.
That's right.
Amen.
That's why you walk out and step out in faith. Faith, confidence in what we hope for, and assurance that the Lord is working it out for us, even if we do not see it.
Amen.
Reach it, girl.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
But it's also releasing the need to know, which could be a very hard thing because we think that information is key. And in some cases, it is. Some cases, you do need to know things. In some cases, you do kind of need to have an agenda or you know, an itinerary to do things. Like, I'm not saying not to do that, but we don't have to sit there and say, well, if I don't know what I'm doing in the next 3 years or the next 5 to 10 years, I can't give you my all right now, Lord, because I don't have that information. So if I don't have that, then how can I give you my all? No, he's not saying that. He's saying, come as you are right now.
Amen.
It doesn't matter if you don't have your 5, your 10, your whatever. I understand that you're intended to write out the plans and he will take care of the rest. But if you're not even that far and you're so deep in this, just cry out to him, Lord, I don't know that, but I'm knowing that in the midst of all of this, you're still going to show your favor on me. There's a confidence that goes beneath knowledge. Not having to know everything, but having the confidence that whatever's about to take place will take place. And praise unto him all the more in the midst of it.
Yes.
You see, in Philippians 1, 15 to 17, this is stuff that all Paul couldn't control. He wasn't able to control these things. He's bound. He's in prison. But then when we go to 18 and it says, but what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, wherever, from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through prayer, your prayers, and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out to be my deliverance.
Amen.
So he already knows that he's coming up out of this regardless what he endures in the midst of the storm. He knows that he will come up out of it.
That's right.
Peter wasn't sure. He was uncertain. But he went when Jesus said, come. And when he took his eyes off, he was taking his eyes off of the word. And when he took his eyes off the word, he began to sink. But then he looked back at the word. He looked at Jesus. Again. How are you allowing your light to shine behind the bars? We all have some type of storm. We're all going through some type of ailment or some type of... No, we're not even claiming that because we already claimed it, all the ailments were taken care of. So,
amen.
Reverse that. But we all had storms at some point in life.
Amen.
We all have been through them. We've all had losses. We've all had trials. We've all had things that we had insecurities about. We all have had those moments. They're temporary. Because what you went through last year or the year before, you're not standing, more than likely, you're not standing in that same exact storm.
Amen.
You've been pruned a little bit, as long as you have allowed God to prune you.
That's right.
Are your actions and your focus with your confidence all aligning so that people out there can see your light?
Yes.
Yes, this is the house of God. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful place to be in. But we as the people are the church. And just like he can break the walls of Jericho, why do we need walls? It's a beautiful place to come and gather together, but why do we need walls? Why do we need walls so that people out there can not see our light? We need to be out there and have our light be shining, period. We need to be walking in our truth. We need to be walking focused. We need to be allowing our light to shine, because if we don't allow our light to shine, how are you being an example for the person who is making a way for you? I just hope that anybody who may be a part of a complaint committee, you give your resignation today.
Amen.
That's right.
And I speak to myself also. This is me too. Trust me. Because I can murmur. I'm a good murmurer at times. I can out-murmur the murmur without you knowing I'm murmuring.
When you get to be our age.
Preach. Ow. Woo. Ow, ow, ow.
Right. Where was I at, though? Well, we already spoke on that. So we know that we can do all things through Christ, which strengthens
yes.
us.
Amen.
And we know that God will meet all of our needs according to the riches and glory in Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So with that being said, in Ephesians 6:10, finally be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Make sure that every day you're putting on that armor of God.
Yes.
Make sure that you're covering that beautiful head that God created you to have. Because your mind will allow you to either go this way or this way.
Right.
Your thoughts are important. That's what's lined up with being focused. If you're not focused and your mind's not right, you're never going to be able to get to that point to where you need to be. So I say, allow God to do a new thing in you. Use your confidence to pave your steps. For God, all things, and he makes a way, even though we do not see the way. So in that being said, whatever you're in, I was shorter than my dad. Was I shorter than you?
Huh?
Was I shorter than you? I thought I was preaching. No, but in reality, I mean, there's a lot of, I got so excited when I read the book of Philippians, not only because it was literally three pages, but this might be one of the most powerful books in the Bible to me, period. Just because it's like, you know, we're so well off. We go through things, but we're so well off. You know, we were able to wake up. We're able to come to a church. We're able to glorify God in our states. We're able to go out. And if there were people that said, oh, you know, you'll be killed if you speak of God. And it's like, try me. Like, God's covering me.
Amen.
And if you kill me, I'm going right with him. So it's a win-win.
Yes.
So at the end of the day, no, but at the end of the day, cover your hearts, cover your minds, walk on the word, stay true, stay focused, allow God to use you in ways that you had no idea that you could be used, because I'm standing up here, like when my dad asked me to preach, it was just something about that I didn't want to say no, but I didn't want to say no because I didn't want to miss my blessing.
Right.
I also didn't want to miss the chance that somebody could hear this and need it.
Yes.
And I really hope that whoever's listening as well can be encouraged. And again, the devil looks for ways to attack you. I mean, I'm a newer fisherman, so it's like, of course he's going to come for me. But like, I was prepped. I was ready. And there was a couple of times in the midst of praise and worship and everything that I just broke down and I had to walk away. And I said, not today. Like, devil, not today. It ain't your day. It's not your day. Like, today's the day for me to shine, so let me shine and you do your thing. And amen. So I hope that you enjoyed this so much that you have me back another day.
Yep. Nice. It won't be 16 years.
Amen.
I'll be 79. I'll be almost 83, right? 93. Amen. She said something very interesting. There's a song that's out, and she said, at the end of the day, and I tell you, it really ministers to me every time I hear it. At the end of the day, at the end of the day, he loves you.
Amen.
Doesn't matter what we do, no matter how much we mess up, he still loves us.
Amen.
Let's stand to our feet. We have one more song as we close out this morning. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your word. Father, continue, Lord, to bless Michelle, Lord God. Grow her up, Lord. Prune her. Do what you need to do, Lord. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for each and every one that's here today. That, Father, Lord, we would completely submit to you and give you all the glory and the honor and the praise. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
as we are. He wants to be able to cleanse us, make us pure before him. We thank you.
Come on out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden.
As we sing this song this morning, if you've been encouraged this morning, if you have been touched by the Lord, don't worry about anybody around you. Don't worry about anything. Don't be embarrassed. But the altar is open. If you want to come and just kneel before the Lord this morning, you're more than welcome.
You're not too far. Thank you, Lord. His hand is out, reaching out for you.
So lay down your hurt. Lay down your heart, come as you are.